The Quezon City local government recently named the 6 finalists of its second batch of startup program. It aims to produce jobs for its citizens, promote innovation and entrepreneurial spirit. One of the finalists is Eco Uling by Project Lily Inc. Its founder and CEO Aya Fernandez now joins us on the program. Hi Aya, good afternoon. Thanks for joining us.
Hello, good afternoon. Thank you for having me here.
All right, so we've heard of the Water Lily Charcoal Project, you know, as early as the 90s. And I know that this company was set up back in 2016. So I wonder, how has the technology changed? I mean, moved forward? It's been almost 7 years for your company at least.
Yeah, the technology existed. Well, carbonization itself, creation of charcoal existed way before. But what differs us is our machines, our formula, our technology. Our Eco Uling or charcoal briquettes are made out of coconut shells. You have mentioned Startup QC, and with this venture with the LGU QC, Quezon City, we will use the abundant coconut waste in Quezon City to create another prototype of Eco Uling or charcoal briquettes.
Oh, okay. So you're going to be expanding from just using water hyacinth or water lily. You're now going to be using coconut waste to make your briquettes?
When we started in 2016, we were using water hyacinth or water lily. Through years of research and development, trial and error, our optimized product now is made out of coconut shells.
All right.
Yes.
So it's no longer just water lily.
No, we are no longer using water hyacinth or water lily. However, with this project venture with the QC LGU, we might be considering to use water lily or other available biomass waste in the LGU. Mm-hmm. Quezon City composes the 1/4 of Metro Manila. And so just the coconut waste alone, there's 90 tons average per month. So if there are other available biomass waste that needs to be recovered or to be recycled, we would be open to do the research and development to provide that solution for the LGU. So again, we are not only doing business here, we're also really coming up with a sustainable and replicable solution for the Quezon City government.
So Aya, could you walk us through, I mean, we're not scientists or technical people here, could you walk us through the process? How do you turn, you know, coconut waste in whatever form into your charcoal, your Eco Uling? What's the process? Just very quickly, walk us through.
All right. First, if there is any biomass waste, there is this process called carbonization. Mm-hmm. Basically, we just turn the biomass into carbon, to the element carbon.
How do you do that?
And then after that, it is through this carbonization process. It may be in a machine or manual process where they are put under extreme heat in an enclosed furnace. Lack of a better term. Uh-huh. I'm also not a chemist, but I guess that's how I would best describe it. And then after a few hours, it will turn black or into charcoal. Mm. And then we will crush them. And then we have a machine to process it with a binder. And then it comes out into briquettes that you see. We dry them afterwards, and then they turn into charcoal. So carbonization, and then we crush them, and then we bind them and into molders. And then we finally dry them again to its final form. And then our charcoals now, they last up to 6 hours. It depends on the raw materials, but our current optimized product lasts up to 6 hours, less to no smoke. It's easy to ignite since it's very much compressed. And it has even heat all throughout, constant heat all throughout.
And the ash can be used as fertilizer as well?
Yes, correct.
Zero waste.
To complete the circular economy, or maybe a process of a product where there's no waste, the ash could be used for pesticides. So you just mix it with water and then you spray it on the crops or plants. It can be used as a very effective pesticide.
Aya, just playing devil's advocate here. Essentially, when you describe the process of carbonization, you are burning the coconut material, right? You burn it. Does the energy used up in that and the waste from that process of burning, does that not offset whatever good this product offers?
I think we have to focus on the technical usage of the word burning. So we carbonize, actually. Yes, there is burning if that means the usage of fire. But since it's in an enclosed furnace, the carbon footprint is very, very much lower and significant compared to using lump charcoal or when you are using LPG. In fact, we save one tree for every 12 kilos or 12 packs of eco-uling used. So that's really the impact that we're trying to make. And imagine how many trees are needed to be cut in order for us to produce that amount of efficiency of charcoals. We are 4 to 5 to 6 times more cost efficient depending on the raw materials. So if a regular lump charcoal only lasts for 15 minutes, hard to ignite, and it emits so much smoke compared to what we're doing, that's very much significant reduction of the carbon footprint. And carbonization itself is not, correct me if I'm wrong, if there's a chemist watching, it's not harmful for the environment. So I might need to I might need to consult with a chemist if anyone is watching from the audiences, but I'm definitely sure it is
at least
not
the
environmentally
footprint is smaller.
Damaging.
Yes.
Yes.
In terms of pricing, is this competitive or a little how will the price of, you know, an eco-uling compared to the regular uling?
Yes, when we did our feasibility study, if the regular lump charcoal that has irregular qualities, so much smoke lasts only up to 15 minutes, in the public market, it is around 10 pesos per almost a kilo. Ours is 20 pesos per kilo. And then it can also go up to 34 pesos per kilo depending on the kind of eco-uling that you would need to purchase for your business. Currently, we are doing business-to-business kind of business model. So if there are restaurants out there, interested resellers and distributors, we are very, very much welcome to reach out to you or to talk to you.
So the price may be a little bit higher, but it burns much longer as well. So that more than compensates for it.
Technically, the price is higher, but the cost efficiency is very much effective. Mm-hmm. And it will definitely lower down the cost of your business. And above anything else, you are empowering our coconut farmers, our eco-uling farmers, and not damaging the environment. You are helping us save the remaining forests that we have.
Mm-hmm. And you're also employing PWDs, I understand, for this program?
Our initial staff or initial manpower were persons with disabilities. We're very proud of them. But currently, we have no employed persons with disabilities, but 30%, at least 30% of our proceeds go to Tahanang Walang Hagdanan Foundation, who caters 250, over 250 persons with disabilities through their therapy, education, and livelihood program.
All right. I want to go back to the shift. When you started this conversation by saying you've actually shifted. You started with water lilies and then you moved to coconut waste. I wonder why the shift. Is coconut proving to be more efficient when you turn it into eco-uling? Because I imagine coconut already has a lot of use. You know, it's a tree of life. Nothing is wasted. Even the waste you can use as husk, you can use as whatever. But the water lilies, very few uses, and this is a really good use case. So why the shift?
We are hitting two birds with one stone. First, you are correct that there is no waste, quote-unquote, in coconuts.
Anymore,
but apparently, yes, but apparently in the Philippines, there are 2.2 million tons of coconut waste that end in the landfills. And that is so much. Every month alone from the Quezon City LGU, there are 90 tons that go to the landfills and end up at least 8 years to decompose. Imagine how many government funds, amount of government funds are wasted just to cater to this and how much land mass is wasted instead of using that land to cater to livelihood projects, residential purposes. It's mm-hmm. catered to the land, you know, to cater waste. So that's one, that there are so much coconut waste. Number two, the demand. The demand of our customers, of our clients. We are very much heavy on the research and development, on the technical aspect, on the trial and error, and the scientific research of our products. We are very much grounded on that. So it turns out, after years of feasibility and trial and error, our optimized product is best using the mentioned current raw material.
All right.
But again, we are also open to using water hyacinth again if the demand from our clients would require that. So we are very open to anything, actually. But for as long as it's biomass waste, it caters to saving the environment and there would be a demand for it. Why not?
Mm-hmm. And I guess that's where I want to end this conversation. What's next after coconut? What's the next biomass waste that you think is, you know, tickling your interest? What are you looking at today?
I think more than the raw material, the focus is what's next. Now, what's next on the impact? I think it is best to focus on what kind of impact that we want to have, and that is to empower and uplift the lives of our Filipino farmers. We have gone far, but we have a long way to go as a country to recover existing biomass waste. And now we are on coconut waste, and we would like to solidify and champion to recover coconut waste at the moment and create sustainable communities through the innovation that we are doing.
All right. On that note, Aya, thank you so much for joining us and congratulations. We look forward to more exciting developments from your project.
Thank you so much.
All right.